it's now time for the review that I have been waiting 6 years to do. 6 whole years, you know, years of delays, script problems, production problems, coronavirus pandemic. Well, finally we have it. Bond 25, No Time to Die, the end of the Daniel Craig saga. It's actually really sad for those of us who have, you know, grown up with him as Bond. Time to settle in, folks, with your vodka martinis, shaken, not stirred, and get ready for the ride that is No Time to Die. Hello, my fellow Bond fans, my fellow 007 fans and subscribers. Oh, finally, I'm here to talk about the 25th film in the James Bond film series, which stars Daniel Craig in his fifth and final movie as 007, No Time to Die. There's just no time to die. Da, da, da. I'm sorry. I'm just so excited to talk about it. And just to clarify before I go any further, this is a non-spoiler review. So those of you who haven't seen the movie, this is the video to watch. I will do a spoiler talk later because there's a lot to talk about with this movie. And I didn't want to make a review that was an hour long. So, No Time to Die. Well, it has been a long wait. A very long wait. 6 years, too damn long. But you know what? Sometimes good things come to those who wait, and I am a firm believer of that phrase. We've had so many issues and troubles to get to this point, you know, to get to the release of this movie. We've had, you know, production problems, script problems, change of directors, and then the fucking coronavirus pandemic happened, which delayed the release of the damn thing. So the movie has been delayed so many times, but we finally got it, and was it worth the wait? Let's find out. Okay, so as for the plot synopsis, I'm not going to go into detail because I don't want to spoil anything. But what I will say is that it picks up basically exactly where Spectre ended. And basically the plot of No Time to Die is as follows. James Bond has left active service. His peace is short-lived when Felix Leiter, an old friend from the CIA, turns up asking for help, leading Bond onto the trail of a mysterious villain armed with dangerous new technology. Elaborating that, everybody in this film is basically going after this bioweapon called Heracles, which was developed by this scientist called Valdo, who's Russian. And there's also some stuff regarding Spectre, the organization who we met in the previous movie, Spectre, and some loose ends to tie up with Blofeld. As well, there's a lot of personal drama surrounding Bond and Madeline, and Bond doesn't really know who to trust in this movie, and neither do we. As the audience, funny enough. And all of this kind of leads to the new villain of the film, which is Lucifer Safin, portrayed by Rami Malek. And basically, it all culminates into themes of kind of an ever-changing world. There's a new 007 in the form of Lashana Lynch as Nomi. There's various revelations from the past. I mean, if you've seen the Daniel Craig movies, it's on a similar vein to what we've seen already in the first four movies. And basically Bond has to take down Safin, I won't say any more than that, because if I do, there will be spoilers. A bit of a ropey explanation of the plot aside, what did I think of No Time to Die? You know, I have been a big supporter of the Daniel Craig movies, and I make no apologies for that. I mean, I genuinely believe his movies are fantastic. They are just amazing. Well, except Quantum of Solace. So I was thrilled to know that Spectre was not going to be his last movie. And I was glad that he was coming back for one more to just finish up the story, you know, to tie up loose ends. I too, like Barbara Broccoli, believed there was more of a story to tell. And she was right. You know, if I can sum it up in one word, No Time to Die. Wow. I was floored by this movie. I've seen it twice now. I watched it the first time on the day it came out, and I watched it also tonight with my family. And both times, I was struck by how moving this movie was. They really meant it when they said this is an emotional Bond film. It is a divisive Bond film as well. There are some story decisions which may not sit well with everyone. I shan't reveal what they are for spoilers, but I too was surprised how much I actually, you know, was with those story decisions. You know, at first I was reluctant about some of the things that were rumoured to happen in No Time to Die, but, you know, I was overall quite happy with the way they did it, you know, the way the climax of the movie was handled. But anyway, a lot to talk about, so let's press on. I mean, this is Daniel Craig's last performance, and I'll do a proper sort of tribute at the end, but as for his performance in this film, I think Craig is great. You know, he's never given a bad performance, even in Quantum of Solace, which I still think is his weakest movie. We get to see more emotional layers to him, but we also get to see a funny side. You know, there's times when he's cracking jokes, especially when he reunites with Blofeld. I mean, that's a great scene because the tables have now turned. I mean, in Spectre, Blofeld was the one who was kind of, you know, smug about having Bond in his clutches, whereas now it's the reverse. Blofeld is in prison, and Bond is making light out of that. And there's some great moments between the two of them as well. Some very intense moments as well. I shan't spoil them, but yeah, I liked the return of Blofeld. I thought he was also quite good, Christoph Waltz. I mean, he's only in the one scene, so don't get excited for his return too much, because he's not in it that much. But I like the way that Craig played opposite him, and I just like Craig overall in this film. He really, I think this is the most human his Bond has ever been. It really feels like across his five movies, there has been an evolution of his character. Like, he went from this really arrogant, kind of cocky know-it-all to now a really sort of mature, a man. You know, he's really come of age, and he's really shown, even though he's a killer, you know, that he does have a raw side. And I think that that's lovely to see. You know, over the course of the five movies, we've seen him really open up a lot more. And he really has, he's still keeps the kind of cold assassin side of his persona. Of course, he doesn't lose any of that, but, you know, he really is great at what he does. And Daniel Craig, honestly, he is going to be missed, but I'll save the tribute for later. Another cast to talk about is Lea Seydoux. Lea Seydoux, who was in Spectre, is returning for this film, has returned for this film. Madeleine is different in this movie. Yeah, she has a lot more layers. We get to find out a lot more about her. In Spectre, she was quite withdrawn, and she was very mysterious, and all we knew was that she was the daughter of Mr. White, and that she was a psychiatrist. But now they've really taken time to develop their romance with her and Bond, and I think Craig and Seydoux's chemistry is much better in this film. Maybe that's one of the nitpicks I had with Spectre. I mean, I love Spectre, but I thought maybe Bond and Madeleine could have not fallen in love so quickly, but now it feels like they have, you know, fallen in love over the time that they've spent in Italy. And I think that makes up for Spectre, you know, and I think the people who disliked their romance in Spectre will hopefully appreciate it a lot more in this. Whilst we're on the subject of Lea Seydoux, all the female characters in this film I think were handled really well. I mean, there's been so much controversy about this movie, you know, Bond going woke and all that, and I choose not to see it like that. You know, you choose to see No Time to Die how you will, but I choose to see it as a Bond film that caters for all. Cast-wise, it utilises its characters really, really well. And I think the female characters... Let's talk about Lashana Lynch. You know, Nomi. She's been a hot topic across the news for many months, but I actually liked Nomi. I thought she was cool. I mean, okay, she's not going to go down as a classic Bond character or a classic Bond girl. You know, she's perfectly adequate for what she's given. And I think she was given just the right amount of screen time to not upstage Bond, because she is an ally. Even though she takes the number 007 for a brief amount of time, and certainly for 2 years when Bond has been in retirement, she's not trying to steal his thunder. And I appreciate that. And the filmmakers acknowledge that. And, you know, there is a point where she does return the number to him. I suppose that's a mild spoiler, but it's nice to know that she at least appreciates Bond for who he is, and she realizes that, oh, he's not actually trying to come back and steal his job back from me. And, you know, that's nice. I mean, they have a bit of playful banter, and they have a bit of tension, but it's very small. You know, it's not like the whole film is them arguing or, you know, her trying to one-up him. I mean, Nomi is cocky. You know, she is a bit arrogant and a bit cocky. But in a way, she's kind of like how Bond was when he was in Casino Royale. And that's kind of how I choose to see Nomi. I mean, she's not quite as emotionally withdrawn. But, yeah, she's different in that respect. But Lashana Lynch did a good job. And I really hope that this doesn't sort of, like, go down as a... You know, I mean, No Time to Die has already had so much controversy. I just hope that people will settle down now, having seen the film and realizing, actually, they used her quite well. Ana de Armas as Paloma, yes. Actually, Ana de Armas was one of my favorites, surprisingly. I mean, she's not in it that much. She really isn't. I think most people have read now that she's only in the one section in Cuba, but her few minutes of screen time are great. Paloma is just cute. I mean, Ana de Armas is hot. I mean, that, let's be honest, I have a big crush on her. Her as a character, the fact they gave her a personality, that's what I love about Paloma. She's not just this, you know, random agent who just comes in just to... I mean, she is a random agent who just comes in to help Bond for the sake of it, but at least they gave her a personality, you know. She's quirky. You know, she's nervous, she's jittery, she's drinking, and there's a lot of banter with her and Bond, and it's not overly sexual, you know. There's a moment when Bond thinks she's trying it on with him, but actually, you know, she wants him to wear a suit because they're going into a party, and they're trying to go undercover to find the scientist. But yeah, that was a nice bit of moment when he said, "Shouldn't we get to know each other first?" And she's like, "Oh no, no!" And she holds the suit, and he's like, "All right." But yeah, Ana de Armas is funny. She's great in this movie. I mean, yeah, she looks very appealing in that dress. I mean, on a practical level, nobody could perform those stunts in that dress without getting a tear. But it's a Bond movie. Let's go with it. And of course, I have to mention the MI6 regulars. I'll start with Naomi Harris as Moneypenny. She's good. I don't think she gets quite as much to do as she has done in Skyfall and Spectre. But I really liked her for the scenes that she had. And especially the scene when Bond and her went into Q's house. Oh, that was great. Moneypenny's quite serious in this film. I think she has quite a lot... There's a lot of stakes going on with the plot, and I think Moneypenny is very, very much trying to keep things focused. So there's not much of her and Bond kind of going back and forth. The Moneypenny's best line is definitely when Nomi says, "Oh, I get why you shot him." And she says, "Yeah, well, everyone tries at least once." I'll try and speed through the cast quickly because this will be a long review. Rami Malek as Lucifer Safin, who is the new villain of the story. I have to say, there's been a lot of reviews that have said he's not that great. And I can see where they're coming from, but I actually disagree slightly. I think Rami Malek is good, and I think he's a solid villain. Perhaps he could have had more screen time. Yeah, I'll grant that. I mean, that's probably my only sort of nitpick with the movie. I think Safin could have been utilized more, but when he is on screen, he is chilling. My goodness me, that opening scene where he goes to the house, I will say no more about the scene, but and he wears the mask to go and infiltrate the house. He is chilling, and his accent and his voice, the way he talks like this with this very raspy voice, you know, James Bond, we both eradicate people. I thought Malek's choices as an actor were very good. Maybe it was the writing. Maybe the writing could have given him slightly more to do, but his final battle with Bond is pretty brutal. I not going to say what happens. Hush, hush. I think Malek did a solid job. Is he the best Bond villain? No, he's not. But I think he's pretty good for what he got. Okay, we've also got Ralph Fiennes as M. What really surprised me about this movie is how much tension there is between Bond and M. And M is sort of, well, M has secrets. I like that they kind of change things up a bit. I mean, No Time to Die is definitely a film that tries to subvert the Bond formula, oh so slightly. It just tries to kind of, you know, ramp things up a bit. I like the fact that it ramped up Bond and Mallory's relationship. You know, it added some tension into the mix, which was really good. Ben Whishaw as Q, very good once again. I've loved Ben Whishaw. I really hope that the MI6 regulars stay after this film, even though Craig is leaving. I really hope that they get to do more. Also, shout out to Rory Kinnear as Tanner. This is Tanner's best performance by far. Oh, and of course, Jeffrey Wright returns as Felix Leiter. I mean, he's not been in the film since Quantum of Solace, so it's been a while since we've seen him, but I'm so glad to have him back. I mean, he's not in it that much, but when he's there, it's great to see him and Craig in the bar in Jamaica and when they're, you know, gambling or whatever, and they're drinking, and they're, you know, it feels like there's definitely a strong friendship there, and No Time to Die wants to make it clear about that, which I really appreciate. We've also got a couple of new characters. We've got Dali Bensala, who plays Primo, who is a henchman. who seems to have a bit of an eye problem. He should have gone to Specsavers. I don't know why they didn't use that line, probably for copyright reasons. But yeah, Primo's pretty cool, actually. I like the fact that he has this bionic eye that he uses, which comes in very handy for the plot, I must say. We've also got David Densick, who plays Valdo, and he was actually surprisingly good. I thought he was quite funny, and he added a lot of comedy into the film, which was really cool. And the only other person really to mention is Billy Magnusson as Logan Ash, who is... he's an assistant to Felix Leiter. I think he works in the private sector or something or other. Yeah, there's some revelations about his character, which are also quite interesting. Again, no spoilers. He definitely turns out to be somebody who you don't expect, which is good. And I like the fact that the film constantly surprised me. You know, at points I didn't know where it was going to go. And I felt that the writing was very good in the sense that it made you... finally the audience feel more like Bond in this story, because you just feel like I don't know who to trust as well. Sometimes we can't even trust M, we can't even trust Nomi, we can't even trust Ash, we can't even trust Felix, you know, Safin, you know, all of these characters have a reason for Bond not to trust them. And even Madeline as well, I should mention as well. And the revelations regarding Madeline are very interesting, and I like the fact that it wasn't like a direct copy of Vesper, you know, because Vesper betrayed Bond in Casino Royale. We're made to think that it is that way, but there's actually something else that crops up, which I think most of us probably would have expected. The premise of the movie comes off as something that might seem a bit generic, but because the movie has such emotional depth, it really doesn't bother me that much. And I like the fact that they went for kind of like a basic premise, but the stakes were very high, and almost the grandiose finale reminded me a lot of The Spy Who Loved Me, like something that was of that ilk. And we have the Navy in this one. They are very much a centerpiece of the movie, certainly the finale, which I really appreciate. Also, need I mention, this movie looks gorgeous. Wow, the cinematography just blows my mind. I mean, this movie is so colorful. And I think it definitely tries to adhere to the colour palettes of Skyfall. It doesn't directly copy Skyfall, but it's certainly an interesting homage. And especially when you get to Jamaica, I mean, Jamaica looks... Oh, wow. I mean, Jamaica's probably the best-looking location in the film, but it's so vibrant. It's so vibrant. I mean, all the scenes in Italy look great as well. You know, the lighting, everything. It is just brilliantly shot. And is it Linus Syndrome? Yeah, Linus Syndrome, who did the cinematography for La La Land. Outstanding. I mean, Roger Deakins will always be a god to me for those shots on Skyfall. I mean, even Hoyt van Hoytma, who did the... who was the DOP for Spectre, that film looked great. But this is definitely a much more colourful movie than Spectre, which I appreciated. And there's a couple of bits of humour here and there. It's not all misery and emotion and depression, you know. It is fun. It can be enjoyed as a fun Bond movie as well. Now, getting to the runtime. Yes, the runtime is long. It is 2 hours 43 minutes. It is the longest Bond film to date. And I can understand people having slight reservations about it. But honestly, just judge it when you see it. Because what's the point of having preconceptions about the runtime? Just try and take it how it is. And that's exactly what I did. And I found it to be perfectly fine. I mean, certainly the second act, there is a little bit of drag. But it's not that much. And it... For me, I mean, it only slows down in the sense that there is a gap between, like, the Cuba action sequence and then the next action sequence, which I think is in Norway. But for me, there was enough in the plot to keep it moving. The plot does move at quite a fast rate, so you have to keep up with it, especially because we have Blofeld and Safin in the movie, and sometimes finding out who's working for who, doing what, can get a little bit hard to keep up with. So definitely pay attention and don't go to the toilet during any of those moments if you can help it. But you know what, the plot is very good, and you can tell they've spent a long time in the script, and the script is very coherent. It flows beautifully, and I think it's a beautifully done film. It's a very well crafted piece of cinema, and a very emotional ending for Daniel Craig. The action sequences are tremendous, I must say. The opening sequence, which is quite long, first of all, the house scene is chilling. The most terrifying opening to a Bond film. I mean, wow. And then we've got the Matera escape, which is one of my favourite openings. Just beautiful, the way that the car, the Gatling guns. We've all seen it in the trailer, but the full sequence is wonderful. The Cuba sequence is one of my favorites, actually, with Ana de Armas. That's a really cool scene. I really enjoyed that one. The Norway chase, is a very good sequence. And obviously the finale in Saturn's lair is also very, very well done. On the boat, the sequence on the boat where the big vessel gets flooded, and Bond and Felix have to try and escape, that was thrilling as well. And again, the production design is amazing. It's nice to be back in that MI6 office, but the sets feel so much bigger, and there's a lot of location stuff this time. Everything's just on a grander scale. Certainly feels like a more epic Bond movie than Spectre and some of the Craig movies prior to this. Also, the Hans Zimmer score. I have to admit, I really enjoyed the Hans Zimmer score. I thought it was good. It's not the best James Bond score ever. Now, parts of it actually sound a bit like his Batman scores, you know, certainly towards the end. When he incorporates the No Time to Die song in the score, that is beautiful. And some of the action moments when he incorporates the Bond theme, when it goes dun 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 dun. Amazing. Just simply amazing. And he did a good job. He did a very good job. My favorite track from the score might have to be the Cuba one. The way he cubified the Bond theme was just beyond amazing. The film definitely harks back to On Her Majesty's Secret Service with the score at several points. So yeah, that was clearly intentional. The finale of the movie is incredibly emotional. I must say, there's some several... well, even the last third of it is really emotional when we discover more about the revelations with Madeline and with Safin. And actually, Safin's lair looks tremendous. I mean, it looks like something out of The Spy Who Loved Me meets Moonraker meets Dr. No. You know, it's like The Poison Garden feels very much like all three of those combined into one. It's huge. I mean, it's massive. I mean, it's on this big island as well, which is really cool. Oh, and as for the Billie Eilish song, I've already talked about the song in another video, and I really like the song, and the title sequence was beautiful. It was really good. The only part of the sequence which I don't think works is the part where they're showing faces of other characters, previous characters who shall remain nameless. When they did it in Spectre, it was a lot clearer who was on screen. I sat fairly close to the front, not the very front, but like the front of the middle of the screen, and I still couldn't see who it was. It's because like there's lines going up and down and side to side, and it's not on screen long enough for you to realize who's who. I mean, you can catch Bond and Madeline, but the other characters, it's hard to tell who's in there really. But yeah, overall, all of this culminates into a fantastic film. It was so worth the wait. I mean, Cary Fukunaga, I forgot to mention, yeah, the director is Cary Joji Fukunaga, the first American director for quite some time, well, I think possibly ever. I can't remember, but he did a really good job, especially following Sam Mendes, who is a critically acclaimed director and a very artistic director. But Fukunaga proves he can handle the drama and also keep the traditional Bondian elements, which is really, really great. Like I said, my only quibbles really are maybe Safin could have had slightly more to do in the movie, but otherwise this is a astonishing film. It's an emotionally powerful ending to Craig's era. The ending is not going to go down well with everyone. I totally understand that. I will not blame anyone who hates the ending, but just remember, folks, James Bond will return. He just has a different face next time. No Time to Die, it's definitely one of the most emotional Bond films, and it's such a great send-off for Daniel Craig, and they made us wait for it. I mean, they had to because of the pandemic as well. It is long, but it's definitely worth your time. I will finish up, and I will give No Time to Die a well-earned 10 out of 10. Understand that that's not going to be everyone's, you know, rating, and I understand that the ending is going to divide people. This film is not going to sit well with everyone. I get that. But for me personally, it delivered everything I wanted. Craig is my favorite Bond, and he went out on a high note. He has the best exit of any Bond actor. I mean, or certainly close when you come to, you know, Lazenby's film, but Lazenby was only in one film. But compared to the other actors, Craig has had a brilliant exit. Before I close off this video, I have to give a tribute, because Daniel Craig, wow. This guy redefined the Bond franchise, and the films are really went to a different place with him. I mean, he'd made 5 movies: Casino Royale, Quantum of Solace, Skyfall, Spectre, and now No Time to Die. I mean, 4 out of those 5 movies, I think, are classics. They are brilliant. The films are only as good because of him. And, you know, again, I don't want to sound like I'm kissing his ass, but, you know, genuinely, he is very talented. He's a great actor, and he also co-produced the movies as well, which helps. So he was clearly dedicated to the role. And I know that there was a lot said about his feelings about the part after Spectre, but I think that will sort of wash away now, because he came back for one more, and he proved that he wanted to go out on a high note, and I think he did. Clearly, his 5 movies are, you know, almost an isolated Bond series in themselves. You know, you can watch Casino Royale to No Time to Die and follow one story. It's one long story, which is brilliant. I mean, they can also stand on their own 2 feet. I mean, if there's any of them that are the most individual, Skyfall is probably the one that is the most isolated of the 5. I have to just give him a round of applause. I mean, Daniel Craig, nobody did it better for me. I mean, no disrespect to his predecessors, of course. Like, all of the previous actors who've played Bond have had something. But for me, Craig, he's the closest to what Fleming described. And he may not look exactly how Fleming described, but I don't think looks are everything with Bond anymore. It's not so much about him being, like, a pretty boy. You know, he's got to be raw, he's got to be rugged, and I think Craig gave the characters so much emotional depth. I mean, they certainly tried to do that in the past with Lazenby, with Honor Majesty's Secret Service, and Timothy Dalton in License to Kill, but clearly this was the right time to do it, and Casino Royale won people over. Daniel Craig is going to go down in history as being one of the best, if not the best, James Bonds, and he's going to be missed, man. I mean, I really hope that No Time to Die continues to get the acclaim that it's been getting. It's weird to think he's been Bond for most of my life. I'm 24 years old, and he started playing this character when I was only 9, and I wasn't even a Bond fan then. I only sort of got into Bond because of Craig, you know. I don't think I'd be the Bond fan I am without Daniel Craig, so I have to really tip my hat to him. You know, his films are some of the best of the franchise, and, you know, with the exception of Quantum of Solace. You know, there are a couple of bumps in the road. Yeah, Quantum of Solace, it isn't all that, but you know what? I genuinely believe that, you know, his films are not going to be forgotten anytime soon. And whatever you think of No Time to Die, I just hope that you appreciate Daniel Craig, even if you don't think he's the best Bond, but I personally do. I think he's proved himself, because nobody believed he was right for it. And I think now everyone takes that back. So as a final note to end this very long review, I'm sorry it's been so long, a toast to Craig, Daniel Craig. And that concludes my reviews of the Daniel Craig era. Wow. All 5 movies. I mean, wow. What can I say? It has been an absolute pleasure reviewing the Bond films and reviewing some unofficial ones. And as for the future of the franchise, I've got no clue where that's going to go. I think I'm going to do a video about that when I've talked about the spoilers for No Time to Die. So I've rambled on for long enough in this video, so stay tuned for that. Thank you very much all for watching this review. And will you see No Time to Die? And if you have seen it, what did you think of it? Please comment down below, let me know. And please be civil. I know there's going to be divisive opinions about this film, but please be civil. We can agree to disagree. And yeah, stay tuned for my spoiler discussion on No Time to Die. And I will probably be seeing the movie again at least a couple more times. I think I'm going to go and see it on Wednesday night again. But yeah, seen it twice already. Love it. And I'm so glad that Daniel Craig came and did one more. You know, it was totally worth it, you know. And I'm not going to lie, I actually did have to fight my tears at the end. It was that powerful. It was really well done. And it was something I didn't think they could do very well. But if they were ever going to attempt to do it, this was the time. But yeah, anyway, thank you very much all for watching. Please hit that subscribe button down below for more reviews. And stay tuned next time when I talk about the spoilers for No Time to Die. So until next time, thank you very much all for watching. And as always, I'm Mr. TARDIS11. See ya. Bye for now.